My name is Anrick. I'm a director. I've been directing content for about 10 years. I started working on web-based experiences and then moved slowly into film and virtual reality and augmented reality. Always trying to look at how we can make a story in some simple way interactive so that somebody who is experiencing that story can touch or change or answer or be involved in some way in how the narrative plays out. I remember the interview super well. It was a nice interview. Good questions. And since then, I remember discussing some of the topics that I've been following since then in that interview. Since 2015, I've been working on expanding my understanding of two different things. So virtual reality and augmented reality stories and how those stories are becoming more integrated with the world around us, spatially, looking at how in particular augmented reality inhabits a space and involves the space that you may be in. And that's super interesting, and it's also complicated because every space then becomes different. The story becomes different depending on where you experience it. That's the first thing. And the second thing I've been exploring is how I can just make stories that reach across specific devices more broadly. I think that the landscape of immersive storytelling is pretty fractured. Mm-hmm. Everybody has a different device, and stories are often built specifically for one or two devices, specific because of the complexity of making it compatible. Mm-hmm. So I've been exploring web VR in particular, web AR, allowing people that have any type of device, even people that just have a phone or a laptop, to experience those stories. I think our society in 10 years is going to radically change, but a little bit like 10 years ago, visually things aren't that different. We're going to walk around the same streets, we're going to see the same buildings, and human beings will roughly be the same human beings that they are now. But what we see ourselves, the way that we see the world ourselves, will change. And I think what's especially important is the world is going to start to be different for all of us. We see the same world today, but in particular augmented reality and AI and systems that we already use every day, where our music playlists are different or the news we see is different. You can apply that to the world around us and to the stories that we're going to be telling. We will no longer be experiencing the same story exactly, like Bandersnatch as maybe a very recent example. We will all have our own journey, and the world will look different to all of us. If you apply something like face filters on Instagram or Snapchat to augmented reality wearable glasses like North, which just look like normal glasses, but apply that layer over the real world, suddenly the way that you see me will not be the way that I see me. Mm-hmm. And that the way I see you won't be the way that you see you, or somebody else will see you. We'll all have a different look. Mm-hmm. It's going to be really complicated and really confusing and really fun and really fascinating. And we'll be able, I think, in a way to have superpowers, because we'll see things then that today we can't see with our own eyes. For sure, I think the borders between the real and the virtual are blending, I think, both in terms of our personality and in terms of just purely what we see in the world. Those two layers are coming together. I think there's some interesting work happening both, let's say, at Magic Leap with the Magicverse that they are building, or with companies like 6D AI, who are really aiming to create depth data across all cities initially, and then really reaching beyond that. And once we have persistent depth data all around us, once we've mapped every room, then the virtual, which seems like a place you go to today, will come to us and it will be present. And we can carry it with us. If you think about the vision of Magic Leap's city scale AR projects, mm-hmm. where an augmented reality experience follows you out of the building and down the street to work or home. That's the layer of digital and virtual blending into the real. So I think it's going to change significantly. And I think that our time is going to start to become more balanced between the two. I think mixed reality is going to change what we see and how we perceive it, for sure. I think we're going to have new layers of information or just new layers of expression. Mm-hmm. I love the, and it's a strange niche scene, but it's really coming to the forefront. I love the Instagram makeup scene. And it's not something that's specific to my own passion necessarily. I'm not super into crazy makeup, but it's amazing to see that discipline being applied to digital assets and then blending over into augmented reality. And suddenly people are creating visions of humans that today we don't really have. Mm-hmm. Or if anything, only exist in very niche cultural groups. The idea that how we look is something we choose as humans, and that it can be radically different as opposed to mostly the same, seems very possible in the next few years. I'm sometimes afraid of the virtual taking over my real life. I think it can be difficult today to choose where to spend your time, just in the same way that it can be difficult to choose between friends and family and work and home and alone time. And, you know, we already have some complex matrix sometimes of how we spend our time, and the virtual layers of our lives, certainly of my life, opens up so many possibilities. I mean, the places I could be traveling to literally in my house any day. It's an amazing opportunity and tempting to just spend all your time in there. I could get lost in the virtual spaces that exist today. And if that's, you know, grows, it's going to be incredibly fascinating. If I think about a company like Improbable, which as a mission has a few different interesting layers, but in particular, procedural worlds that are endless, that are just generated, that just exist out of code. I cannot imagine anything more exciting than going to discover a corner that doesn't yet have a human imprint that was created by code. Mm-hmm. Like traveling to other planets. That's for me, it's on that level. Like it's like traveling to another planet, I think. My favorite VR game, I think Beat Saber comes pretty close. I just generally love space exploration. I'm always such a massive fan of astronomy as a kid and of science fiction. And so to me, the best games in VR are the games that take me out into the universe, and even if it's imagined, or onto a space station. Like it's the life I had dreamt of having as a kid. I dreamt that when I was older, when I was an adult, we'd all be in space traveling the solar system and we'd be hopping around. So maybe I don't have a particular one in mind, but I like space games a lot. I remember as a kid playing games and being convinced, as much as my parents might be worried about my obsessive game playing behavior, being convinced that it was teaching me a lot of things. I knew I could tell I was getting quicker at hand-eye coordination. I could tell it was challenging my brain to solve puzzles or to just have my brain think about complex issues. So I've always felt like games were really beneficial. And I think both in terms of the tools and the games that VR or AR offer, that remains true. I think that's really the power of wearable headsets. And the weakness of phone-based experiences is when you have your hands free, you're operating in the world as a full human, and then that connection between your body parts and your brain becomes really, really strong. Beat Saber is an amazing example of that. There's others. I'm pretty fascinated by some of the meditation experiences that exist, some of the games that are much less about action or puzzling, but much more about exploration. I think that's super interesting. I'm skeptical of some of the bigger scientific claims that are being made. I always try to look really carefully at the science behind the work that claims to solve big issues or have a medical have a medical benefit. I think sometimes VR can claim to be doing things that it might not necessarily be doing, mm-hmm. or where the achievements aren't because of the VR, but maybe because of the science that is irrelevant to VR. Mm-hmm. So I think there's loads of interesting things happening. Eye coordination and just fun applied to physical movement like Tilt Brush and Beat Saber are fantastic. But yeah, to me, exploring space in VR, that's like my childhood dream. I think it's a rough journey, and I think there's a few bumps to go, but I do think that we're seeing wearable devices that have the power to do AR coming out. Mm-hmm. I think we're seeing lower priced, powerful VR headsets coming out, Oculus Go being just one example. And most importantly, we're seeing VR devices that do AR, or vice versa. I know the AR headsets have some VR capabilities also. So there's a kind of convergence happening that is interesting. But the landscape remains really diverse, and it can be very difficult as a creator sometimes to understand what platform you're developing for and the cost. I know that from my own experiences, the cost of reconfiguring something for another headset or another device, even within the same VR ecosystem, can be pretty high for indie developers. Mm-hmm. There are beginning to be companies and tools that try to cross that bridge, that allow you to develop, even as a plugin within Unity, for example, in one environment and output to all. And I think that's actually the core. The real advancement being made today in the VR and AR space is actually at the game engine level. Both Unreal Engine and Unity are making massive steps in making it easier for indie developers mm-hmm. to put content into every device, scaling it up or down, depending on whoever has whatever legacy object. And so I think the moment you remove the need to be aware of all the range of options of devices as an indie developer, the more you're gonna be able to just create whatever you dream of making, and that's what the industry really needs, is just a whole range of amazing different experiences. I don't think it went super well. I'm still interested in everything. I think I can report to you after our last interview that I've learned to accept that I'm interested in everything. Mm-hmm. And I try to spend my time a little bit more wisely. So I have specific time set aside for research and for allowing myself to try new tools and experiment with new things. And then I do try to do something which I mentioned in my talk as well yesterday, which is taking a step away from all the technology options and just write. So I've kind of gone towards the writing more strongly. Mm-hmm. I write my stories. I try to think about a story bigger than or not connected to the technology output. And then I try to find places where it could go. And I like the idea of working on projects that are maybe available across VR and AR, that live differently, but have those two different outputs, those two different touch points. Yes, I'm excited. I've just started something big. I'm working on a new project. It's called Drift. And Drift is about climate change. So climate change, obviously, something that I think in 2018 really came to the news. We had some really insane, crazy, extreme weather events. I explored that topic already in my VR game Storm in the past with extreme weather as an enemy. But Drift is going to be different. Drift is about making a connection with somebody who is living 25 years from now. And so our ability maybe to communicate with somebody in that time and to learn from their challenges that are the direct result of our actions or non-actions is going to be an interesting learning experience. This is not going to be a very factual experience. It's not about someone telling you off or, you know, trying to list all the things you're doing wrong in 2019, but through learning and empathy and through a connection with somebody that's living in our future, I think we may be able to learn in a very natural way the longer term impacts. And I think that's what's missing from a lot of the climate change debates that are taking place, the longer term impacts. We're seeing all the extreme weather events happening. We are noticing the shorter term crisis. And I think that it's amazing in 2018, because of some of that, that people are more aware. But we should be thinking 25, 30, 40 year timelines. So that's what I'm hoping to do in a small way, is to build a connection with somebody that has that longer term perspective.